right to life movement essentially is recognizing that human beings matter at all stages. They matter in the womb, they matter in their youth, in their middle age, their old age, in their dying process. At every stage, the recognition, I think, that life is sacred. And that's an opinion that's shared not just by Catholics and Christians, but by Jewish, Orthodox, and Muslims. And basically what the Right to Life movement is all about is recognizing not just the problems of abortion, but also the fact that people have a right to live, a right to live. It's a human right, and the human right is based on a universal natural law principle and applies to everyone all over the world at all stages of their life.
There's a lot of debate over what natural law is, and although natural law is complex and it has centuries long of a philosophical tradition, and it goes for hundreds of pages even in St. Thomas Aquinas' Summa Theologica, there are certain basic elements of natural law that we can understand. Natural law is what the words imply. It is the law that comes from nature. Now, the law that comes from nature can be physical nature. How many times will the moon circle the earth? Those are laws of nature. But when we look at the human nature, we learn from the development of human nature that there are certain laws that apply to human nature, and that if followed, human nature will become fuller and more rich and more true to itself. That's the source of natural law. So what is it that becomes truer and fuller to oneself? Well, that includes an appreciation of one's life, of one's personality, an appreciation of others' lives and of their personalities. Thus, natural law impels us to be social, to be concerned with one another. A true natural lawyer, as Aristotle pointed out, is a social man. He's one who cannot live alone and still be fully human. Is one who must care about what happens to other people. So the rights of others become very, very important to a natural law person. Particularly in our case, we try to apply that to the rights of the unborn.
Well, I think that there are some principles that have a general consensus in our society. It's, I think, the application of those principles to the tough cases, the cases that are tough for us in various ways, that's being disputed or debated. And I think that there is, as part of, really part of our Constitution, in the sense that it's our Constitution relies on the Declaration of Independence, that all men are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, among them a right to life. And that right accrues to us in virtue of our being human beings, not in virtue of just certain accidental attributes that come and go or may come and go. And so that's something that's really written into our constitutional document there. It's really part of the fabric of our civilization. Now, our civilization is not applying that, or not all of our culture is applying that. There's a division, there's a deep division in our culture. A struggle between a culture of life and a culture of death, but we are the ones who are trying to call our culture, all of our culture, back to the principles that our civilization, our country, defined as really the core principles of what we stand for, and we stand for that as Americans, and we also stand for that as Christians, as Catholics, or Jews, or other religions, or even just human beings. We recognize that every human being, in virtue of being a human being, has a certain dignity, has a certain right to life, and a right to respect. And that's what we're calling people back to. And that's why we are making progress here. No one should be discouraged, because there will continue to be a division in our culture. But we are making progress, and we are. There is a good portion of our culture is standing up for life.
The 13th Amendment, which came into effect after the Civil War, abolished slavery, and the 14th Amendment, established that there will be equal protection and due process for all human beings from this day forward, that there would never again be a question as to human beings not protected by the Constitution. So the 14th Amendment is very clear. Ironically, it is the 14th Amendment that the lawyers on behalf of the pro-abortion view have used to say that there is a right to abortion. Of course, there is no right to abortion in the Constitution, and the disordered nature of this is that the word liberty in the 14th Amendment has been misconstrued to mean the mother's interest in doing as she wishes. Of course, in Roe versus Wade, there's a wonderful passage in which Justice Blackmun acknowledges that if at some point in the future we determine that the unborn is also a person, then the abortion case on behalf of the mother's interest collapses. That's the word the justice uses, collapses. Of course, we knew in 1973 that life began at conception. There was no question about that. But the court skirted that issue by saying, we're not going to decide when life begins. We're simply going to take a look at whether or not a liberty interest for the mother is sufficient to encompass this conduct.
I think that in our society, choice or freedom has become a core value. In fact, it was a core value from the beginning. And the champions of abortion, the defenders of it, have appropriated the language of choice. To some degree, I think that it's very important to examine the issue of choice and ask, what is the value of choice? Choice just means options. Choice simply means having A and B and being able to go one way or the other. Now, to me, the value of choice is not simply in and of itself. It is ultimately the value of what is chosen. So similarly, the value of liberty is not in itself. Liberty gives you the chance to choose what is good, to make the right choices. And one of the functions of parents and schools and our civic institutions is to teach young people, to teach citizens how to use freedom well. So I think that when the other side says choice, sometimes we just reply with the rival slogan, life, and then it's two ships passing in the night. I think the way to engage the debate is to say, okay, choice, but doesn't our life depend and doesn't our society depend and won't we ultimately be judged upon what are the choices we actually make?
The primary right we have in the Constitution that's spoken about by the framers is not spoken primarily about the right to life. That was presumed. The primary right that they spoke about was liberty. So it is around liberty that we must join issue with the pro-choice movement. For the framers, liberty meant not the ability to do whatever you want to do. The framers called that license. That was the opposite of liberty. Not an abuse of liberty, the opposite. Because what self-government meant, what liberty meant, was self-government. And self-government meant two things. One, to be able to elect representatives so that you govern yourselves politically. It also meant self-government, the capacity to develop virtues and to become a full flourishing human person. And a full flourishing human person does not engage in libertine or licentious activities. He uses his liberty productively for the assistance of his own flourishing and for the flourishing of others. So that is the notion of the right of liberty that the Founding Fathers have. The notion of the right of liberty that modern pro-choices have is much more circumscribed. It's much more narrow. It's the right to do anything within a small private space, not to have connection with others, not to develop a collective spirit towards the good of all. That's the liberty that they have, and it is a very small liberty.
Well, I think that the fundamental dignity of life is the core issue. That is the root of it all. And if you don't attribute moral significance to life, If you look, for example, at humans as simply on a continuum with the other animals, or simply as a patchwork or a network of molecules, then it becomes difficult to say why we should be, why any of this matters. So I think that the power of this movement is that it goes back to first principles. It comes back to who are we, what do we care about, what is sacred to us. And I think in that sense, that's an issue our culture has lost sight of.
I think there's certainly enough, and there's an adequate amount of factual scientific information. I do not think that this scientific knowledge has permeated the general community adequately to realize that the human heart is beating within a few weeks after conception. The neurologic tissue is existing. These neurologic tissues can receive pain. The motor and sensory function can function 5-6 months after being in utero. And I just don't think that the general human, the general populace is astute enough or aware enough or educated enough to understand that children, even 5 months of viability, sometimes are born prematurely. And we can put them on respirators. Children are born at a pound or a pound and a half today, and they're put on respirators and fed in neonatal intensive care units. And within 2 months, they're 7 pounds, or 6 or 7 pounds, and they go home. So after 5 months of gestation, babies are viable. They can be born, and they can be placed on a respirator for a period of time and supplement. Babies are seven months old. Many of these infants are light for, not so much light for days, but lightweight. But they're born, they don't even need oxygen supplementation. So the concept that this is not a child or a baby until it comes from the mother's womb is extremely erroneous and inaccurate.
So a lot of times people act as if, sometimes people think that it's a conflict between science and religion here, and we hold that the human embryo or human fetus is a human being because of our religious belief. But this conflicts with science. Well, that's just not true. Science is on our side here. The embryology texts all say that the human being comes to be, the human organism comes to be at fertilization. Okay? The evidence for that is overwhelming. The sperm joins with the ovum. The sperm and the ovum cease to be, their constituents enter into the makeup of a new entity. That new entity is an organism. It's not a part of the mother, not a part of the father. It has the program, the genetic, epigenetic program that gives it an active disposition to develop itself to the mature stage of a human being. That shows it already is a human organism.
I think that the pro-life argument is embedded in a larger view about human beings having a special place in nature and in the world. And the concept of the transcendent is a part of that. It gives, if you will, elevated significance. It makes it impossible to look at human beings purely from a utilitarian point of view. What use is this person to me? And I think that to the degree that we are eternal creatures in the world, our life is a kind of image of eternity. So snuffing it out becomes particularly bad. You're not just disposing of something that is here and will pass away anyway. You're in a sense stamping out the image of the eternal in the world. So I think that you may say the spiritual landscape gives depth to the pro-life movement. And part of arguing the pro-life case is arguing for that transcendent meaning of human beings.
And I think the problem today is that we're moving into an age when people are being judged by their characteristics and not by their intrinsic value. Characteristics like their health, their wealth, their age, their beauty. And ultimately, each one of us matters. We're not just matter. And I think that's the other thing, that science is beginning to push us, and some of the atheistic tendencies are pushing us more and more to the view that human beings are commodities, things that can be disposed of if they're no longer useful. And that's a really dangerous movement in world culture, and particularly American culture, the culture of death, as we call it.